Welcome to Dr. Charles Speaks, a podcast for now. Dr. Charles is a nationally recognized Fortune 500 business leader, a former adjunct professor, speaker, and ministry founder. With over 30 years of exceptional performance in both business and ministry, he will share his profound approaches to developing successful leaders. Let's get motivated with Dr. Charles Speaks, inspiring excellence and generating results.
Have you ever felt stagnant in your leadership, or felt like you was in a rut, or felt like you could not move up the corporate ladder? I like to share with you today three principles, and I've chosen the character of Moses. And inside these three principles, number one, is recognizing the hand of God in your life. And number two, there's going to be adversity, but being persistent in the midst of adversity. And number three, remaining humble. That's the key to it all, staying humble. And this story, you're going to understand and you're going to realize that you too can be an overcomer and an effective leader. Stay tuned. Good day, this is Dr. Charles Redd, and I want to talk to you about a subject that's entitled Jumpstart Handoff. And this particular subject matter ties into leadership principles that I like to share with you. I've chosen today a character that I'm just excited about to share with you, and his name is Moses. And you can find Moses in Deuteronomy 34th chapter, 10th verse. And there arose not a prophet since in Israel like unto Moses, who the Lord knew face to face. I want to share with you three ways of initiating leadership change for a future handoff. And those three leadership changes, one is recognizing God's hand in your life. And then two, being persistent in the face of adversity. And then finally, three, humility is serving God as a leader. That is so important. And what we learned over the 120 years of Moses' life, Moses embraced those three principles. And I want to share with you. When you think of Moses, Moses came from being a prince to a shepherd, to a leader of over 2 million people that he exodus out of Egypt and led them to the place of the promised land, Canaan. It's so exciting to recognize this story because one, here is something that you can relate to and that I can relate to as well. Moses, he was not a perfect individual. He had sinned, he had committed murder, but yet when he was exiled, God had forgiven him and had changed him and began to mold and shape him into the very person and leader that he wanted him to be. When you think about that 40 years, those 40 years being away from a place of wealth and having all of his needs met in the place of Egypt, but yet he had to leave that place and he learned quite a bit. There have been desert experiences for us all. We've all have faced desert experiences in our lives where we felt like we were all alone and did not know which way to turn. I'm sure Moses felt that way. He could not return back to Egypt, but yet he found a wife, he found that they had two wonderful children, and he had a relationship with God that he was building upon each and every day. God met him in the desert, and that's where God will meet you. And he's met many in the desert of our lives, when we have perhaps given up on life, given up on the promises of what God has prepared for us. And I can think back on my own life. God shared with things with me many, many years ago, and I was very excited about. But lo and behold, it's taken many years for them to manifest themselves. And I felt too, being in that desert experience. How many can relate to that? Being in a place where you had the promises of God to stand on, but it didn't seem like they were going to be coming anytime soon. But yet we see in this desert where Moses was that God met him in a bush, a burning bush that would not burn up. And he spoke to Moses. And though Moses felt like perhaps he would never return to Egypt, after all, they knew that he had killed a soldier there and that perhaps he would never be able to return. But God yet sent him to the place where he had wealth, he had prestige, but yet he was exiled. God sent him back. What a challenge that may have presented to Moses. But Moses was going back not in of himself, but he was going back with God being in charge and being his leader and being the master and taking him to that place. What was he going back there for? To make one simple request to Pharaoh, let my people go. So here was a person that realized he had some situations going on in his life. He was not a great speaker. He had a speech impediment. He was a person that was not really felt that he was up to the task that God would have. Can you think about a time when you felt like you weren't up to the task? I can remember in corporate America, my first management job, not feeling that I was up to the task, but relying not on my own strength, but recognizing that, God, I need you to lead me. I need you to help me to be successful, that I may lead these people. We can lead people in our community. We can lead people in our church, in our corporate world. We can always be a leader, leading from the front. But yet there are times we may feel inadequate. We may not know what to say and how to say it. But God promised to Moses, I'll give you the words to say. And so this leads to this first point, as we talk about recognizing God's hand in the move. God was in it all along. Yet Moses had to repent for what he had done and his sins, and he did. And as a result of that, God was able to use him. And so God sent him back to the Pharaoh. And yet he made several requests to Pharaoh. Pharaoh made several promises, and he broke promises after promise, which leads me to my second point. Moses had the persistence in the face of adversity to continue to face this Pharaoh, continue to go back one promise after another that was broken by Pharaoh. And yet God was there in the midst of it. He purposely hardened the heart of Pharaoh, but yet Moses still stayed to God's plan and stayed obedient unto God's word and the will of God. And he would go each time and Pharaoh would say, okay, and then he would change his mind. He would go another time and okay, and he would change his mind. But yet this persistence in adversity, when you've given your life over to Christ, it's not an easy road to heaven, from earth to heaven. It is a walk of faith and a walk of hope and a walk of determination to continue to strive forward, because your past will always come back to remind you of what you did and how you did and what you should have done. But yet and still, by the power and by the love and by the grace and by the Holy Spirit, we're able to make our way through the adversities, through the peaks and the valleys of life, and be able to stand in the midst of a storm, and the rains may come down on each and every one of us at any given point of our lives. But we see in Moses that God didn't give up, and God is not a respecter of age. Yet Moses was 80 years old, having been 40 years in the desert. How many of you have probably felt like, I'm ready to retire at 62 or 65? But yet, I got news for you. God may not be done with you. There may be another chapter for you, another desert experience, another time where you may spend some years in learning more about your personality and about God himself. And Moses took this time and he went, and yet and still he felt inadequate. But even in God's promise that I would be with you and I would give you the word to speak, Moses still needed to have a right arm with him. And that right arm was his brother Aaron. And Aaron, who was a better orator than Moses, went along with him. And the two of them worked together through the persistence of what God would have them to say and to do. And as a result, Pharaoh did relinquish after losing quite a bit, losing a lot of property, a lot of lives, and yet and still, as they left and they exited the people of God, exited Egypt, Pharaoh even had a change of heart once again. And then so as Moses is leading them out in this wilderness experience, and yet he finds himself with the Red Sea on his back, and there's no escape, and Pharaoh's army is on their way to destroy them. And so they, at that time, it was a point of decision. What should we do? And the people were murmuring and saying, well, you brought us out here. Where should we do? Where should we go? That was their complaint. What, you took us to a place where now we're going to die out in the desert. We could have done this in Egypt after all. But Moses, in his persistence, in his confidence in God, he reached up with his staff and he called out to God. And God said, stretch out your arms. And the Red Sea opened, and the people of God traveled across on the other side. And the story ended where the people of Egypt who came after him, they all got drowned in the Red Sea. So we see the persistence in the face of adversity. It didn't stop there, because as Moses realized through all of this and all the years of wandering in the wilderness, there were times and episodes where they were out of water and the people were murmuring, or there were things that were different strifes were happening between the people, and someone had to resolve those different disagreements and things of that nature. There were times where they complained that the food that God was giving them every day from heaven was not enough, and that they wanted meat, and that they felt like they had better meals in Egypt. But through this all, and all of the adversity of facing within his own people, he was obedient unto God. But we do find, even in adversity at times, we sometimes get off track. We sometimes will get off on the wrong road. And Moses, you know, he was doing his very best. He had an intimate relationship with God. He would meet him on the mountaintop. He was the only one that we know that saw God. He didn't see him face to face, but he saw the backside of God, and he heard the voice of God, and he was there in the midst of God, and he received the covenants and the Ten Commandments and all of that. But it came to a place where they ran out of water, and they got to a place where God had specifically told Moses. He said, look, Moses, this is what you do. You go back down to the people, you go to this rock, and you speak to the rock, and I will allow the water to gush out and have plenty for all of them that are thirsty. But Moses, in all of his frustration and hearing all of the bickering and all of the murmuring, Moses, he struck the rock with the rod twice, and the water did come out. Of course, the people received the goodness of the water coming flowing freely out of the rock, but yet Moses did not follow God's command, and he didn't follow, and as a result of that, Moses was not allowed to go into the promised land. So you can see how close you can be to God and be in the conversation and be among as a friend and a servant, but yet God takes what he gives us to do very seriously. And in this case, Moses, he paid a price, but yet God did forgive him. But the consequence of that situation did not allow him to enter into the promised land. He did get a chance to look at the promised land from a high view on top of a mountain, and God continued to communicate with him in such ways to help the people. But he died but never seeing that promised land. But the good news of the day is that God took the situations and took where Moses was and had his hand in his life from an infant all the way through the time of death. He took him and he nourished him and he trained him and he developed him and he became an effective leader. Which leads me to the third point of humility. I've talked to you thus far in recognizing God's hand in your life, and two, being persistent in the face of adversity, and now the humility in serving God as a leader. You know, with all of the complaining and all of the bickering that the people gave him, I can just only imagine myself just really throwing my hands up and saying, you know, that's it. These people, they're stubborn, they won't listen, they're not following what I have to say. I'm just going to go it alone and do, or even ask God, why me? But yet and still, he stayed to the course. He stayed to the course, but then wisdom entered into the picture, because Moses was trying to do it all himself. He was one that was trying to answer all of the needs. He was one to try to solve all of the disputes among the people. And then his father-in-law, Jethro, came onto the scene and spoke some wisdom into his life and said, Moses, you know, you have to humble yourself to the extent of this. You cannot do all that you're trying to do. There's only so many hours in a day. How many of us can relate to that? So many hours in a day where there is only so many things that we can get done. And can you imagine being over 2 million people and just to say that maybe 1,000 people had a complaint for that day? How long would Moses have to sit there and listen? It would be all day and not enough time in a day to even get a decent night of sleep. But Jethro's remedy was, look, let's break up leadership. Let's get people who are capable. Let's get people who are after God that won't fall to bribery. Let's get the folks that are godly people, and that let's set them aside and have them oversee the people and get down to at least one leader over every 10 people. And Moses took that advice, and that was a sign of humility and a sign of recognizing that doing it this way, he would be able to meet the people right where they are. Versus being able to just talk to all of the people, he could serve them through others, and they could be in a situation where people could be helped. And so we see in this whole lesson that in leadership, in this jumpstart of Moses setting the tone for generations to come, he eventually passes the baton on to his lieutenant, his second man in part of this ministry was Joshua. And Joshua took the people and they went on. Even though the people realized that when they got to the promised land and they peeked over and they actually scouted and they saw that there were giants in the land and that they were afraid to even cross over. But yet and still, God's promises are still true today. And eventually they did cross over, but Moses didn't see it. But in this leadership lesson and the principles that we learn one, recognizing the hand of God. God is certainly in our lives. If you're interested in Him, He's interested in you, and His hand is in your life. Two, we recognize that even though God is in the midst of it, and even though God will give you the instructions to lead your life, there will be times of adversity. And in that adversity, we must stay persistent and continuously following the leading of what God would have us to do. And even in the times of frustration, and we may have missed the mark, get back on our bended knee and ask God for His forgiveness and continue on along the journey. And then thirdly, just stay humble in all that we do. Imagine going from being a prince and being a shepherd and being a leader, and all of those points of interruptions and intersections, we see that Moses grew and he matured and he became more trustworthy, that God could use him. We're going to sometimes take detours. We're going to sometimes take other avenues that God would have us visit first until He gives us that big assignment. And many of you are on the verge of receiving that big assignment from God. But understanding these principles of knowing that God is in the midst of it. Because if God be for you, who really can be against you? And being in the face of adversity, there's no weapon formed against you that shall be able to prosper. You'll be able to fight more than you ever thought you'd be able to do. You'll be able to do exceedingly and abundantly above all that you ask or think, according to the power that worketh within you. Stay humble, my friend. If you remember these principles, you too can be a part of a jump start and a handoff. And who will it be in your life that you will make a significant difference? God bless you today. It's been a pleasure of talking to you. And I look forward to the next time we meet again. This has been Dr. Charles Redd. Thank you very much.
Thank you for listening to Dr. Charles Speaks. Visit drcharlesredd.com for booking info for your ministry, business, or leadership team. Get info about the Red Line, a 15-minute corporate success call each Monday morning with Dr. Charles. Follow Dr. Charles on all social media at Dr. Charles Redd. Subscribe to the podcast here for every episode of Dr. Charles Speaks. Thanks for joining us. Like Dr. Charles always says, no matter what, never, never, never give up. Until next time.